The 18th century began with a bang. The War of Spanish Succession spiraled Europe into a 13-year state of warfare. In one corner were the Spanish and French empires, fighting for the legitimacy of the Bourbon Philip V's crown, and in the other, the British and the Habsburg empires. The war resulted in a British-leading peace settlement, established at Utrecht in 1715. To Spain's delight, Philip remained on the Spanish throne. However, Britain acquired holdings in Gibraltar and Minorca. Behind the scenes, the treaty changed much more in Britain and France than just lines on the map.
It was really a transformative conflict. The 18th century saw an uncharacteristically isolationist England combined with liberal reform under Walpole.
Born in 1676, future Prime Minister Robert Walpole was raised in a family of 19 children. It was in these early, chaotic years that Walpole set himself apart from the crowd. After being elected to Parliament, Walpole rose through the ranks of the Whig Party, becoming a key part of the parliamentary machine. In 1721, Walpole became the first de facto Prime Minister of England, as power transitioned away from the monarchy, continuing a trend that began after the Glorious Revolution. George I became King of England after the death of William of Orange's successor, Anne. As an aloof German, George was more than willing to cede power to Walpole's emerging political dominance. For the next 21 years, Walpole ruled Great Britain, greatly expanding its commercial and military power while broadening political rights for Englishmen. But his secret to success? Aligning the nobility.
Walpole was visionary in granting noblemen special autonomy over their local dealings. This flexibility made this previously stubborn aristocracy willing to serve the interests of Britain and Walpole. Then the noblemen were absolutely delighted to see the dwindling power of the crown diminish even further.
By the end of Walpole's reign, Britain was a world power, and the modern system of cabinet government was established. Walpole had shifted the British government completely in a visionary direction, becoming maybe the most progressive nation in all of Europe. But the British Empire wasn't the only world power that underwent major political changes.
Following the death of the Sun King, Louis XIV, France transitioned into an awkward phase. Because of Louis XIV's young age, sunk at the temps, France felt uncomfortable in crowning him king immediately. Therefore, the Duke of Orleans became regent.
Philip II, the Duke of Orleans, was an extremely corrupt ruler. Suffering from a gambling addiction, it was a miracle he climbed the political ladder of France. The worst decision of his brief regency was handing the reins of the economy over to a fellow gambler and Scottish mathematician, John Law.
John Law, he was a terrible Scotsman. He was perhaps even worse than the Duke of Orleans himself. You see, John Law owned a monopoly, titled the Mississippi Company, and appointed workers in the organization to control national debt. And eventually, the Mississippi Company failed to pay back its shareholders in gold, which created an economic collapse in France. We call this the Mississippi Bubble.
Like Walpole, the Duke of Orleans attempted to entice the French nobility to aid in the management of government through the creation of administrative councils. However, the nobility was pampered and disinterested after decades of life at Versailles. As Britain's gentry served their country in the military and in politics, the Duke's experiment floundered. In spite of this, French nobles retained their extravagant privileges, using them to restrict the authority of the monarchy. Their power was exercised through high courts called parlements, which held final say on whether royal decrees could be implemented. During the reign of Louis XV, the parlements called the shots. In 1726, the more absolutist Cardinal Fleury became de facto ruler of France, attempting to re-establish the primacy of the monarchy in Paris. Often compared to Walpole, Fleury differed in his illiberal repression of the Jansenist sect, moderate Catholics with beliefs deemed too similar to Protestantism. As Britain moved towards liberalism with a quiet nobility, across the Channel, France struggled with maintaining the Sun King's absolutism under the weight of aristocratic resistance. The two leaders sought similar international directions for their nations, with both Walpole and Fleury de-escalating continental geopolitics to make room for overseas expansion and economic recovery.
Walpole's tenure was marked by unprecedented peace and prosperity. Britain mended fences with France and Prussia in 1725 and cemented an alliance between Vienna and London in 1730. He even prevented George II from intervening in the War of Polish Succession in the mid-1730s. To Walpole, war on the continent wasn't worth the fuss.
Cardinal Fleury is an interesting figure because he is a corrupted mirror image of Prime Minister Walpole. Staunchly fundamental at home, Fleury mostly parallels Walpole in his approach to foreign affairs. He isolated a skirmish between England and Spain in 1727, preventing escalation to a wider war. The cardinal limited France's role in the War of Holy Succession in 1733 to campaigns in Germany and Italy. Fleury saw his role as janitor in Louis XIV's administration, sweeping away further costly wars to allow France to recover.
Despite its fiery beginning, early 18th century Europe was surprisingly tranquil. Much of that tranquility can be attributed to the leadership of Robert Walpole and Cardinal Fleury. France and Britain followed similar diplomatic and social paths in non-interventionism as well as incorporation of nobles into government during this period. But on the political front, Britain drifted towards liberalism in contrast to France's continued efforts to remain absolutist. It seemed Europe was undergoing an enlightened shift, a movement toward delicate reconciliation between great powers. However, tangled dynastic relations continued to threaten an enduring peace. By 1740, as the Emperor of Austria's health deteriorated, storm clouds gathered on Europe's horizon.